One of the things that the chairs are really agonizingly going through right now is filling out the membership in order to capture the diversity of the community. And one of the debates they're having is, to what extent should you have on the task force people who may represent interests that would be affected by the task force directly? And so obviously, schools are a major piece in terms of providing opportunity. I can tell you, growing up in a low-income household myself, with a single-parent household and one or three kids, I am the first person in my family to go to college. I would not be here today were it not for the local public schools. It just would not happen. And so that's critical, but we also have Urban League and Urban Ministries and a whole host, and the other institutions have a whole host of these other institutions that are going to be part of the solution. And so do you bring them in as part of the input, have them bring their knowledge and expertise and research and science to the table, or do they become members of the task force itself? Unfortunately, I'm not making that decision. The chairs are working through that. So I can't tell you precisely how they will be involved, but I can tell you with certainty that we will have not done our job if we don't involve them in an appropriate way.
Sure.
Well, this is the, sort of the best kept secret, isn't it? I mean, they've been really secretive about this whole thing, and so we don't know what they're going to announce at 1 o'clock today. I'm the MC. I'm not going to MC something for Miss Congeniality Prize, though. So I think it's huge because nothing else is the it is the brand that it brings, and where it positions Charlotte as a technological community. I think that's important for our economic and for our global image. And it will also drive AT&T and Time Warner, probably soon to be Comcast, to do more and better, so that gigabit's not going to be limited to Google. There's going to be a rush to the top with Google coming in. And where I'm hoping it's going to be particularly beneficial is to the entrepreneurial economy. Be those sole proprietors that are working in their home, that are creating and thinking up new things. I think it's going to be a huge boom for home businesses, which then can move out into shared offices. And I believe it is Kansas City. They've got these people that, it's sort of interesting, they bought up a bunch of single family homes that was in a transitional area that was converting. And they actually use them at home, got Google Fiber in there because they're doing residential first, but they're using it as sort of a miniature office space, sort of an incubator for new ideas and new businesses. So I think we're only limited by our creativity. And I do believe small business and entrepreneurs and sole proprietor home workers are going to be part of our economy. That will provide us, long-term stability and opportunity for folks. My wife was a single proprietor consultant for most of her career, and it was really rewarding for her and gave her opportunity to do things you couldn't do in the institution. That's a tough question. That is definitely a really tough question. It is going to be evolutionary. One of the things I really try to ask people not to do is to pit one part of the city against another. I'm based on my long experience, both professionally and academically, I am a deep believer in that more is more. And so that Ballantyne is phenomenally successful actually ultimately helps the West End. That Uptown is successful, that University, more is more. And so as we're making this transition from a suburban mentality where we just grow out and start moving in, when you come to these close-in neighborhoods like this, then the vision is going to be more compelling because of the proximity. You know, you talk about real estate, it's location, location, location. This is one of the things that makes this area up here so exciting to me, because the proximity to the uptown core is so close that for the long term, you can't avoid investment here. The question is, how do we shape it?
Yeah.
So that it's not kicking everybody out and gentrifying, but it's growing organically that preserves what's special here while inviting new investment. And that's where the friction's going to be, especially if we're able to bring transit here. It is going to make us money in the future. It was a really bold and I think creative effort to get the NASCAR Museum here. And I'm learning a lot about NASCAR. Even though I'm from the South, I'm not a natural NASCAR person. But I'm learning a lot about it, and what I'm learning about it is the multi-billion-dollar industry that it is in this area. It's not just about the museum, it's about all the other automotive stuff that goes along with it, which brings jobs and taxes. And so this reinforces that industry. And the money that is going into this project is money from the hospitality tax that's being paid principally by visitors to our city. And it's being, what's being done is it's being reinvested to bring more visitors into our city. And so it was a partnership with the city, the CRBA, the Visitors Authority, the NASCAR, and the banks. It didn't fulfill its original hopes and dreams, but everybody came together and made some adjustments to get to the new reality, which I think puts us in pretty good shape. With regard to Chiquita leaving, believe it or not, this is actually a little bit of a blessing, because right now in Uptown, we have no block of office space for a corporation that wants to move into Uptown. It just doesn't exist. We have lots of little pieces of space, but if we had a new company that wanted to move in Charlotte tomorrow and go into Uptown, we have no place to put them. And so now we've got a place to put them. That space, I think, is going to be backfilled very quickly. I don't know how quickly Chiquita's going to get out. It would almost be okay for us if they, you know, went soon. My one concern, to open up the space. You know, Chiquita doesn't actually exist anymore. I mean, people talk about Chiquita, you know, misrepresenting. Chiquita doesn't exist. Chiquita's been bought up by another company.
Tom.
The Chiquita plan was to actually stay in Charlotte, but it's a new company now. Well, the key in Charlotte is of course what we have underway with Blue and Walk Up to do with the Gold Line. And that's all we have resources for right now. So the biggest nut we have to crack in our future financially is how do we fund transit going forward. This is going to be the next big public policy challenge. You can ask any of the council members here or outside about this and they'll tell you the same thing. We've got to figure out a way to fund our next, we need to have transit out to the airport. And we have to get phase three of the Gold Line out Central and up Bates Ford, or else we will not have really gotten the full benefit of transit. That really opens up the opportunity. So it's going to be a hard community debate, and it's going to take some while for us to go through it. But I think we have a mayor and council committed to having that public discussion, and certainly administrative staff, professional staff, we're committed to it because we think it is our future. The most inefficient form of transportation is owning a private car. And where people have transit available, young people aren't doing it. They don't want to spend their money on cars and insurance and repairs. They want to drink and eat and go to football games and go to concerts. They figured it out, and if we don't offer them transit, we're not going to attract the young people. The young people are the future. And so that's why it's so exciting that in our current transit plan, we're connecting our academic institutions. Johnson C. Smith, Johnson & Wales, the community college, UNC, Charlotte, both the main campus and downtown, and the other schools that we have represented in Uptown. With the Gold Line, the Blue Line, all that stuff's going to be interconnected with transit now, and that's going to drive young people to not just come to Charlotte, but stay in Charlotte, and that is so critical for our long-term future. For city and county employees, I think it's an interesting question because you do wear two hats sometimes. You wear a city employee hat, you're an employee, and then you're also a resident, so you have concerns. I think what is important, what I recommend, is that you work hard not to confuse those two roles, that when you are speaking as a resident, you clearly are speaking as a resident and not as a city employee. And when you're speaking as a city employee, you're doing so in recognition of the policies and procedures and responsibilities as a city employee. And I've known a number of people over the years that do that really well who were activists in the community. I've known other people that confuse the role and just creates confusion both in the workplace and in the community. I also think it's really important for I've talked to about city employees to work issues internally as well. You know, if you're a city employee, you can get to me directly. All you do is send me an email or call my office or come by. And so you have access. And so having, you know, talking to people that you have access with, both appointed officials, but elected officials. This is a great thing about local government. You have access to people. So you can have a lot of individual conversations that make a difference without necessarily testifying at a meeting. Testifying is just one way to do it. It's not the only way to do it. And it's not always the most effective way to do it. And so it's taking advantage of all those different strategies to make sure that your voice is heard, especially when you're trying to speak up for what's important for your neighborhood and where you live.